Hey guys, I'm back. We're going through our second series of Q&A that I get from my Instagram followers. So if you have any questions, please send me a DM or when I post a story that's asking for questions, add it in there and I pick just a few. Last time I ended up picking 5 questions and I think the video went a little long. So this time I'm gonna just pick 3 questions to see if we can kind of get this over and done with in 10 minutes so it can be on YouTube and also on IGTV without having to go to both locations for you guys. So let's get started. So the first question, and this was kind of 2 questions that I got, I'm gonna sum into 1 answer. So was, what are injury prevention like tips for a jumping athlete? And then the other question that I got was, how long do I rest before a psoas injury? And it's hard, anytime I get questions that ask me a timeline based on an injury, one, without knowing the athlete, just getting a random message, I can never give a yes and no answer. Even me as a physical therapist, when I treat my patients and they say, hey, how long till I can run? How long till I can do this or whatever activity that they wanna do? It's hard for me to give an exact timeline of saying, yeah, in 6 weeks, you'll be good to go because of this answer. So I always say injuries happen because of, I'm gonna use a bucket analogy, stress versus recovery, okay? So you have 2 buckets. One is filling up with stressful items. You have another bucket with recovery, and that is filling up with recovery items. So examples, stress. Let's go back to track and field. Stress, your training is technically a stressor. Lifestyle things are stressors. So this is why technically getting less sleep can be a stressor. Getting, say you have a huge test coming up, that can be a stressor. Say you get in a fight with your boyfriend, that can be a stressor. So all of these things can kind of fill your bucket up. So say your training wasn't too bad this week, so maybe we only fill the stressor bucket up to there. But your mom called and something, you had a big family issue, and that increased your stress up to there. So now your bucket is almost all the way full. Like we're 3/4 of the way full of stress. So say then you add your next week of training and we start to topple over. We don't have enough room in this bucket. Well, the only way to then prevent an injury is make sure your bucket on the recovery side is bigger to not allow you to fill up the stress bucket. So what are some recovery items that you can help kind of take water out of this stress bucket to kind of make sure we don't topple it over? Sleep, there are so many research studies saying that athletes who get 8+ hours of sleep have a less risk of injury. And I get it. I was a college athlete. I was a high school athlete. There's times when you can't get eight hours of sleep with everything you're doing. But with proper time management, you can get pretty darn close to this. I coached and competed and was in grad school for 3 years and did pretty darn good. So it's possible. Your time management and your priorities just have to take set. And this was a good quote that I'm taking a course with Altus right now, and this was a really good quote from one of the videos that I read, is you have to make a decision. You can't look at it as a sacrifice. So you're choosing to be a college athlete. You're choosing to be a high school athlete. You're choosing to want to go for your goals. So you have to make that decision. Don't say you're sacrificing your friends to win a championship. You gotta pick and choose, and it's your decision. You have to decide whether right now you need to hang out with your friends or you need to focus on getting more sleep for your event coming up the next day. So Next thing, hydration. Hydration is an easy recovery tool that can help. A lot of times we're not drinking enough water throughout the day. Make sure you have a glass of water, a water bottle with you, like at all times, and you'll always make sure that you're drinking enough water. Nutrition, same thing. I get when you go into college, there's a huge kind of new learning curve for all these freshmen. I mean, my mom cooked me dinner every single night when I was in high school. I didn't have to make that conscious decision of, oh, I need to go make sure I eat some vegetables, or I need to make sure I'm getting enough protein to carb ratio and stuff like that. Like, you most of the time leaned on your parents to cook you that meal and make that decision for you. Now you're a freshman in college, you walk into the cafeteria and there's pizza over there and there's subs over there and there's ice cream that you can eat on an endless basis. Remember, you probably didn't eat ice cream every single day when you were at your parents' house, or else your parents probably would have yelled at you. I mean, mine would have. So remember that as you're making these decisions in the cafeteria. You can't eat ice cream every day and expect to run a 10-9 in the 100. You know what I mean? So think about those nutrition. And these three are the cheapest recovery tools that you can use. I get there's the compression therapy out there with the boots. I get there's cryotherapy out there. I get there's millions, the Theraguns. I can name a million and one recovery tools that you can go buy. But guess what? Sleep is free, water is free, and nutrition, I mean, it's not free, but it's probably still cheaper than going to buy a Theragun that might help you a little bit, whereas nutrition will help you a much longer route. So think of those three things. Another thing that could act as a recovery tool is a hobby. What's a hobby that decreases your stress? Maybe it's getting a good novel and reading a little bit of a book, and that can de-stress you. Maybe it's drawing. Maybe you like to draw. Find a hobby that can decrease your stress. Maybe it's meditation and yoga. It is all different for every single athlete. So that's kind of where you have to make that decision. Next is then the rehab. So yes, if you come down with an injury, there should be some sort of rehab process, whether that's mobility exercises, whether that's strengthening exercises. Again, that's a very dependent and individualized to you and to the injury that you have. What is causing the injury is a huge kind of question. You have to find the driver of the problem to fix the injury, or else you could still always come up with that chronic injury, that chronic hamstring strain. Does it come down to your mechanics? Does it come down to your strength? What does it come down to? Many times it comes down to this kind of stress recovery model. Your training program is either too much versus your recovery, so kind of finding that balance. Many times it's your technique of what your technique is doing. And then other things can be like your lifestyle. And I just want to note too, I put friends and family in the middle, and because they can technically, I think, be on both sides. They can be a stressor when shit happens, and they can be a recovery tool when you need somebody to talk to and you have that sort of person. So these can kind of fall in each bucket, and it just depends. And that's how you, one, prevent injuries, is making sure your recovery bucket is more than your stress bucket. And then the other thing is making sure if you do have an injury, we need to really load up on the recovery bucket, decrease on the stress bucket to work that through. So that's my answer for helping with injury prevention and how long a timeline is for an injury. So, all right, next question is, what are exercises to help with your vertical jump? So I could sit here and say, you need to do this, 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 and this. Well, then I'm bullshitting you, because you can do a million and one exercises to improve your vertical jump. So let's go back to the science portion of it. Your vertical jump, which I'm going to point out with this little guy here, is all based on your ground reaction forces. So what ground reaction force you put into the ground, it's going to give you back. And then, so that breaks it down into your strength of how much force and power you can produce to go up. Now, there's certain muscle groups that help you go straight up rather than out a little bit, and that's gonna change the ground reaction force as well. But think about working on your strength. I mean, strength is a huge, huge thing. I mean, working on your squats, working on your deadlift, working single leg. It depends. You have to also think, like, when you test your vertical jump, it's off of two legs, which is great. But a lot of times in sports, like with basketball, a layup is off of one foot. In track and field, you're off of one foot with the high jump, with the long jump, with the triple jump. You're never off of 2 feet. So it's awesome to improve your vertical jump. Do I think that will transfer over to some of those sports? Absolutely, because of the strength and power piece. But don't necessarily look right out a vertical jump of, okay, I need to increase my vertical jump because that's going to increase my ability to do long jump further, because not both of those are specific to each other. So, I mean, so for strength portion of it, go into your squats, your deadlifts, go into a nice strengthening routine to get your strength up, and then add the plyometric strength or that power component of that short lengthening component for your plyometrics, and to learn how to quickly do it, and that will help your vertical jump. So going into your jumps, your box squats, there's a million different plyometric exercises that I could sit here and name and you could YouTube. So, I mean, the amount is endless. Like, you can choose a million different exercises to help increase your vertical jump. But the biggest thing too is you just have to be consistent. Like, if you only work out for 1 to 2 weeks, guess what? Your vertical jump isn't gonna do much. Or if you do the same thing, you need some variability and you need to increase your strength over time. Like, I don't know how many times, and this is a little bit of a pet peeve of mine, how many times when I see athletes in the weight room lifting the same weight for 4 to 6 weeks, guess what? You're wasting your time. Like, you have to increase that stimulus or that force output. So remember that you need to increase some of those in the intensity or the frequency. You have to play with those sort of things. So that's my answer to the vertical jump. I could sit here and give you specific exercises, but I would rather you go be creative and kind of make up your own thing. Last question I'm going to answer today is, what should incoming freshman training be like this summer for the sprints, hurdles, and jumps? It shouldn't change from any other summer. I know we have extra time right now, which has kind of made me wonder if I should change my training, but really it still comes down to your functional base, which I write over here. It's made out of like three major factors. Your acceleration, okay? So with sprints, hurdles, and jumps, you need to work on your acceleration. Before you can improve your top end speed, you have to learn how to accelerate. So learning how to accelerate, learning your acceleration drills, working on that first 10, 30 meter amount of your sprint is going to be the best for you. So working on your acceleration, working on your speed, then working on your top end speed. I mean, you can't work on speed endurance without speed. So having the best functional base going into your fall preseason and is going to help you the best. Be able to work on technique when you finally get a coach around you, and work on your other strength endurance and just keep building on that functional base much more. And then strength is the last thing. And strength I break into two parts is absolute strength, which is in the weight room, doing your squats, doing your deadlifts, increasing that strength output. And then your plyometric strength of you jumping, doing your box jumps, doing line jumps, doing Bulgarian split jumps, doing flying lunges. I mean, I could sit here and name a million plyometric exercises, but working on those three things are going to be your big thing that you want to do every single kind of summer off-season training program going into your preseason training program for track and field and for those sprint and power athletes. So those are my three answers for these questions. If you have any more, please send me a DM, like I said in the beginning of the video, and give me a follow on YouTube if you haven't. Thanks, guys.